for an entire generation, people have experienced Star Wars the only way it's been possible, on the TV screen. But if you've only seen it this way, you haven't seen it at all.
This is the podcast you're looking for.
We've been waiting for you.
The Force is strong here, even stronger than the coffee.
This is John Morton, Dak from The Empire Strikes Back, and you are listening to Coffee with Kenobi with Dan Z and Corey Club. This is the podcast you're looking for.
We are thrilled to welcome John Morton to Coffee with Kenobi. John is best known to Star Wars fans as Dak, Luke's gunner during the Battle of Hoth from The Empire Strikes Back. John is also a regular contributor to the official Star Wars blog, as well as a veteran performer, both in film as well as theater. He's a published author and a senior national security analyst. Each semester, John gives the introductory lecture to the Homeland Security elective students at Washington's National War College, a component of the National Defense University. We are honored to have a cup of coffee with such an accomplished individual. Welcome, John.
Well, it's great to be here. I love to be around a tap calf where people are having blue milk, coffee, or anything else that they fancy.
Perfect.
Conversation's usually pretty good with those stimulants.
That's right. Well, we've got the right ingredients here, and we've got a Star Wars icon with us, so there's nothing wrong with that, that's for sure. So we'll just jump right into it, John. How did you get involved with the Star Wars franchise?
Well, that's sort of a three-part question in my case. Obviously, as a working actor in London in the 1970s, I went through the general procedure with how you get parts in films and in theater. I went for an audition. In this case, it was just a case of going into meeting with the casting director, who was a woman named Irene Lamb, who was very well-regarded and quite well known in the business and did a lot of interesting and big work in London in the 70s. And she looked at me and said, you know, based on your credits and the work that you've done before, I think you'd be right for something in Empire Strikes Back. And we'll get in touch within a couple of weeks. So she did. She got in touch through my agent, and I knew that I was being cast as a rebel pilot in Empire Strikes Back. So I reported onto the set. This was in about March 1979, and I was pretty excited. And when I arrived, I only had in my descriptive a rebel pilot, and I was told right away, hey, you're going to be Mark Hamill's co-pilot.
Wow.
And I thought, hey, this is going to be pretty cool because everybody's going to remember his co-pilot. And they said, yeah, well, that was the good news. The bad news is you're already dead. A Norwegian extra had kind of taken the bullet for me when they had just come back from filming the Hoth sequences, actually on location in a glacier in Norway. And actually, the crew had just come back from that about a week before I was called. And so that was kind of fresh in people's minds. The second part of it is I had a good career going through the 70s and 80s until I came back. I had a film in development in Hollywood, and over the course of the next couple of years, ultimately the film deal went south, and I gradually migrated out of the film business back into theater in New York, and then finally leaving show business altogether. And I came down to Washington, D.C. in the 80s, early 80s after that, and got involved in defense journalism, which really was a throwback to before I was in the theater world. And it was in 1997 with the re-releases, while I was really a working conference director and defense journalist in Washington with two young daughters, that I was found by the Star Wars community and brought back to life by Star Wars Insider. And I started doing appearances in those days, really, because the fans were trying to, you know, get all the people that had been involved in Star Wars to the conventions and whatnot. And so in 97 is when I started doing the convention circuit. And I did that pretty often until about 2003, when things were really getting hot and heavy for me in D.C. And I didn't really get back into it until my youngest daughter, Emily, who by that time was in her late teens and early 20s, said she wanted to go to Celebration 5 down in Orlando. And so my wife and I went down there with Emily, and she got kind of hooked into the Star Wars world. And I started doing appearances yet once again, this time with a little bit more regularity. I do about one a month now, both in the United States and in the UK.
Wow.
And as you know, I started blogging for Lucasfilm. They asked me if I'd be interested in doing that last February. So I've been blogging for Lucasfilm really for a little bit over a year. So that's a long answer in three parts to how I got involved in the Star Wars franchise.
Excellent. And isn't it wonderful how your daughter got you back into it? Always through the children, it always gets us back, doesn't it?
It really is. And you know, I, as part of the witness for both my daughters and myself, she was having a little difficulty. I would say she was drifting over to the dark side a little bit in just after she graduated from high school. And we were having some communications issues, which, you know, parents and children sometimes have when they're in their teen years.
You bet.
And I had already turned down, actually, Ben Stevens' invite to go to Celebration 5 because I was still pretty busy in Washington. And Emily came and asked my wife and I if I was going to Celebration 5. And I said, no, Ems, I told him I didn't have time to go. And she said, oh, that's really too bad, Dad. I would have liked to have done that. In which case, my wife metaphorically kicked me under the table. And, you know, John, if you had suggested that, she would have said no. But the fact that it's her idea, hey, there's the overture. Let's do it. And so I called Ben back, and fortunately he said, yeah, we still can fit you in. We'd really like to have you down here. And I said, can I bring my family? And he said, yes. And it was at that point she started expressing an interest in working conventions. And subsequently in Celebration 6, she did a little bit of work with one of the Star Wars elite squad, Nancy Lutz, who was a close friend of Mary Franklin's. Mm-hmm. And she did one panel working with Nancy on, I think it was origami, as I recall. And the next year or so, I guess it was last year, Ben invited me down to one of their conventions in Dallas. And I asked Ben if Emily could come and shadow his team. And he said, yes, of course. And she came down with me and she shadowed there. And then we asked Mary Franklin if she could join the elite squad. And Mary said, absolutely. And so she was able to do her first work for Lucasfilm at Celebration 2 Europe. And she went over with me and did a great job. And now she's going to be at San Diego Comic-Con working for Mary and also for Ashley Eckstein.
Wow.
And she's been actually doing a lot of bookings for me. Most of the bookings I get are through her, both sides of the Atlantic. And she's also, you know, one of the representatives for four of the Power Rangers who we've gotten to know doing the circuit. So she's gotten pretty tight with, as I say, four Power Rangers. And she's trying to put some deals together for them, which is pretty exciting for her.
That's incredible. I think that's a great story to be able to connect Star Wars and fandom together and obviously tie in with your family. I think that's wonderful.
Oh, it really is. You know, guys, I got to tell you what a thrill it is to be doing something with one of your children. And in fact, I'm blessed doubly because my eldest daughter, Margaret, is a lieutenant in the Navy. And she is now a navigator on an Aegis cruiser. And part of my day job is supporting the Aegis project office in Washington at the Navy Yard. And so I have an understanding in that sort of Washington side of my life of exactly what daughter number one is doing while she's at sea in the Pacific. And because I'm working so closely on a daily basis with Emily, on Star Wars, I'm you know, intimately involved in her life and understand what she's up to as well. So it's just, it's a great thing, which I never would have believed I'd be doing. And it's just very rewarding, I must say.
Well, certainly some great connections with, when, you know, with both your daughters and both feet in both yep. camps there. I got a question here about your involvement with Star Wars and Luke Skywalker during Empire. Now, if you can think back to, you know, that scene where Luke's climbing and getting ready to fly off into Hoth there, his progression as a character, as we've seen so far, he's taken out the Death Star and he's kind of a burgeoning leader, if you will. What kind of symbolism is that for Luke as a leader psychologically? And how has he grown as a leader and a rebel pilot?
Well, I think you might be reading a little bit more into it than the technology and the particular aircraft, you know, suggests. I think what was most significant in terms of his leadership qualities and his capabilities was flying the X-wing, you know, in the action at Yavin on the Death Star, because he was piloting an attack aircraft. You know, obviously, you know, he had the capability with the astromech in the back, aft the cockpit. But in the case of what was going on Hoth and what he was doing, the snowspeeder was a two-seater by design. So the fact that there was a co-pilot who really was a weapons officer manning the harpoon that was, you know, facing aft. I mean, that's that doesn't suggest necessarily a progression. Looking into things from a military perspective, that happened to be the aircraft that was at Hoth, and you flew what you had, as Rumsfeld always used to say about certain things. You know, when he was Secretary of Defense, for better or worse, he said, "You come to the party with what you got," and I think in the case of Echo Base, that happened to be what they had. So I don't think. I mean, that's a long answer to an interesting question. That in itself
sure.
suggests how far he's come.
Well, we like. Since I'm an English teacher, of course, I have to read too much into it. That's my job.
Yeah,
well, I kind of like the idea of the fact that he's carrying his friend's rebellion on his back. You could look at it symbolically that way, and he's taking on more responsibility, and he's coming into his own as a Jedi Knight.
Well, that's really true, and that might lead into the question, which I get asked often: what was he trying to do when he went back into the cockpit just before the AT-AT? You know, stepped on the aircraft.
Left a cell phone there or something.
Well, people usually think he was either going after Dak or he was going after his lightsaber.
Oh, he was going after Dak. He had to go after you.
Well, that's what I think. You see, I think the backstory of Dak was that Dak had a lot more that was he was responsible for, you know, than just, you know, being the weapons officer. I have a sense that he had either a data card or what have you, that it was not a holocron, but something, you know, akin to that, that had all the records that an astromech would have, say, for an X-Wing. And that's why Dak was Luke's co-pilot, so to speak, so that there was definitely some importance there. I'd like to believe he was coming back to try to get Dak out, but he was pretty well strapped in and unconscious.
Well, it sure seems pretty clear, by the way, they interact when he says he can take on the whole empire by himself. It's pretty clear that they have some sort of a history together.
Yeah. And a lot of that stuff is fleshed out in, you know, the role-playing games that West End did. And from my understanding, some of the early X-Wing games, Dak was very well known in the 90s. In that kind of extended universe world that was present particularly for the gamers.
Sure.
And that's not something I have too much knowledge about, but I certainly do know about the backstory that West End produced before Leland Chee came aboard to be the master of the holocron.
Right. Yeah, they did beautiful work there. They really fleshed out a lot of things, and of course now it's known as Legends. So you're a legend. We already knew that, but now it's confirmed.
I had the privilege. You see, at that point, when they found that I did writing, Lucasfilm arranged for me to go up and meet the folks in Honesdale, which is in Pennsylvania near Wilkes-Barre and Scranton, up that way. And that's where all of that group functioned out of, in the sort of up above the Lehigh Valley in Pennsylvania. So not too far north of Washington, right outside of New York. And I did the whole tour of the facility. Interviewed all the people that were doing the West End Journal, which was where a lot of the fan fiction and stuff was being published for the role players. And, I got all the books that had all the role-playing stats and what have you and biographies. So the reason why I was there was that Lucy Autry Wilson and Sue Rastoni, who's now working for Steve Sansweet, they were in charge of the book division. And they had ideas that I was going to, at that time, expand on Dax's backstory from the first person and sort of accompany the kind of material that Mike Stackpole was doing if they were going to continue that sort of X-Wing series.
Sure.
But the change in a year or so, by 1998-99, they decided with Del Rey to focus on the prequel material rather than that part of the timeline. Sure.
And it almost seems as if the pendulum is swinging back the other way. So who knows?
Well, the pendulum is indeed swinging back the other way, and which is why I'm very much involving myself with the timeline around Star Wars Rebels and that period before Empire.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, really, really looking at five years or so before the Battle of Yavin, to 5 years, 2 or 3 years after.
And if our listeners could see some of the emails we've shot back and forth, some of your insights already, it's pretty exciting. I can hardly wait to see what's going to happen when Rebels comes out.
I think it's going to be a very significant advance on Clone Wars, which is going to tie in a great deal with the films. I think my understanding from everything that I've had access to, and some of the things I have to be careful what I'm going to talk about because I don't want to get in trouble. But I think the way the story group and the producers are working in with Rebels in Episode 7 is that the continuity and the storylines will all weave together fairly seamlessly, and I think they see that as very much of a positive. I mean, when you think people like Pablo Hidalgo, Carrie Beck, Leland Chi, they are all guys and gals who'd come into the Star Wars as people who grew up with it. They've been doing this and deconflicting a lot of the stuff with the expanded universe for many years. And yet you've got other people coming in like Dave Filoni and others who also grew up with Star Wars. Simon Kinberg is another. They feel about the Star Wars legacy the same way, in my experience in talking to these folks, the same way as the fans do. I mean, I'm an old guy in my 60s now. But here you got people in their 30s and 40s who, and early 50s in some cases, who grew up with Star Wars as children in the 70s. See, I was in my 20s at that time. And that's very precious to them. And I heard Pablo state very clearly in the New York Comic Con presentation he did on Rebels back in October.
Mm-hmm.
That it was a great thrill for him to, having played in the sandbox or in the proverbial backyard with Star Wars characters and Star Wars imaginations, he's now able to be a part of developing things as an adult to advance stories that he was imagining when he was a little guy. And his familiarity with all the toys, there was the trooper vehicle, transport vehicle.
Yes.
He was very excited about that, that there was something that never appeared in the original films, but Kenner had made a toy out of it, and that's something that he was aware of, and suddenly it's going to be appearing.
That's amazing. Yeah, and Steve, doesn't Steve have a full production size one now at Rancho Obi-Wan?
That I don't know, but
I think there might even be a blog about it on StarWars.com. I'll send you a link. I'll find it.
I missed that. But you see, that's the kind of honoring that's going on there. So when I hear people sort of saying that this is not going to be cherished to the degree that the fans would expect or want, I don't buy it. I think
I don't either.
I think you got the right. The people that are in there running the show now are fans.
That's right. And that's a beautiful thing. There's just so much richness to Star Wars. And speaking of that richness, I learned recently, and I know a lot of other fans had too, not only were you Dak, but you also made your appearance in The Empire Strikes Back as Boba Fett on Cloud City. So I have to ask you, how much were you asked to mirror Jeremy Bullock during that scene? And how much of the Boba Fett swagger that we all know and love today have you brought to the role?
Well, actually, Irving Kirshner the directors that I worked with at the various times in the 4 weeks that I was there were Irving Kirshner and George Lucas and Gary Kurtz. I don't recall them saying anything to me about how they wanted Boba Fett played. However, as a professional actor and honoring a fellow professional actor, I said to Jeremy, kind of tongue in cheek, what's my motivation here? It's usually, sort of a standard actor, question.
Yes.
When they don't know. But Jeremy knew what I was saying. I was saying, essentially, you're Boba Fett. You tell me how you want this thing played.
Wow.
And he said, play Clint Eastwood.
Oh, wow. Oh,
cool.
And he's often said that there's a connectivity with,
Sergio Leone films?
Yeah, that's the way he interpreted the character. And I think that's what he brought to Boba Fett, Lucas or... Or Gary had said Boba Fett's going to be like Clint Eastwood. But anyway, as far as I'm concerned, Jeremy conveyed play Clint Eastwood. So he said, I want you should be doing everything very slowly and deliberately. Play it with menace. So I remember distinctly looking at the costume and the helmet and thinking it's sort of a man-machine weapon system. At the time, I saw that that sort of antenna as a radar sensor device. I'm not sure whether it's a communication. I think Jeremy says actually it's how he communicates, with his
Slave One.
His Slave One. But at the time, I was thinking, okay, well, this is a sensing device of some sort. So I remember when Dave came around off my right shoulder to face me. I looked over to my right and imagined myself as a radar, a targeting system, tracking him very purposefully. And so I just followed him around slowly like a gun turret. Mm-hmm. And as I said in some comment to the Star Wars blog just when I started, when somebody was asking about that, I said, I had this sense that I was not impressed with Vader at all. He was a target that I was going to take out if he made one move.
That's so wow. Cool.
And so that's how I played it. Now, interestingly enough, one fan came for my signature Celebration 5 or 6 down in Orlando. I can't remember which. Celebration 6, probably. And he asked me, what did you do as Boba Fett? And what were the scenes that you did? And I explained, and I said, and I finished that scene in the passageway by following Vader down to the lift, the elevator at the end, where he disappears through the double doors. And he said, "Ah, yes, I knew that wasn't Jeremy." He said, "You just didn't walk like him." And I thought to myself, "Yeah, it's possible that I stepped out of character, and I could see myself doing that to the extent that David, being a very tall guy, 6'7", with a long stride, I might have had a little difficulty keeping up with him, and so I might have sped up a little bit. But this one fan had detected it, and I don't know.
I'll be darned.
Yeah. But, you know, those kind of things, the detailed work that a good actor does or does not do, it is noticeable, either consciously or unconsciously. And with Star Wars, people see those things so often that if you're really an obsessed fan and you're wanting to get every detail and studying everything, I mean, I can see people would have done this with Eastwood if they were trying to understudy him in A Fistful of Dollars or what have you. They would have watched very closely everything that he was doing and every mannerism. This guy picked it up, and I'm not, you know, I looked at the scene myself and I thought, no, I didn't do that too badly, but somebody noticed.
It was seamless.
Somebody noticed.
That's a great story. I love having all the little behind the scenes and things like the stories you have told us so far have been incredible. I just could sit here all day and you know, getting back to what we were kind of talking about, you talked a lot about the folks who are working on the story group and things like that, and for Rebels and you know, as Star Wars as a whole, and you know, as a culture, what do you think Star Wars teaches us in culture and society, and why do you think it has endured for so long?
Well, I think that George did a marvelous job, which was acknowledged by Joseph Campbell himself in his discussions mm-hmm. with Bill Moyers, if you'd seen those that were on PBS, and they're available, I think, on YouTube. Certainly I've read the transcripts, which were published in a beautiful book with pictures and what have you. George seized upon Joseph Campbell, who was a remarkable social scientist or psychologist of the Jungian school, who was deeply involved in myth. And we in London were very aware of Campbell's work. In fact, my wife, who was working for the New York Times at the time, came across his Hero with a Thousand Faces and gave it to me for my 30th birthday. Which was a year or two before I did Star Wars. And so I was kind of aware of that work. And what essentially A Hero with a Thousand Faces told was the story of the hero's journey, the rite of passage from innocence to experience. And George captured this. And I think when you read about the making of Star Wars and various books and what have you, he was looking for a mythos, if you will, a hero's journey that was something that could be expressed for our time. Now, in the 1970s, the United States, even though I was in England, I was still very aware of what was going on in America, and part of the reason why I was in England was I just didn't feel like I wanted to be in America at that time. That was suffering in many ways as with a hangover from Vietnam and Watergate, at least for people my age, and I don't say children were affected that way. For people my age, I think it was a difficult period. I just didn't, you know, I wanted to go on my own hero's journey and do that in London, and it worked out really well for me. But what was needed at the time was, I think, what George captured, which was a new myth mm-hmm. that was going to bring people together with a sense of meaning to rebuild their world. And he went back to some of the serials from the 1940s and 50s, like Flash Gordon and what have you. But he was updating it with certain other concepts, which were, instead of seeing things necessarily in opposition to aliens that were going to come and do bad things to Earth, that you had all sorts of people in the universe that were on these heroic journeys. And then they're basically, Earth wasn't necessarily the good guy and aliens the bad guy. In fact, Earth is not even represented here, but you do have human beings that essentially what was people were coming together around, good people, was a battle of between good and evil. And so you had this space opera that was all out there at a time when we were going into outer space with the Apollo program and exploring different worlds, instead of dwelling on the negatives socially, he was putting together some positive views of the battle between good and evil, and looking outward into outer space and the galaxy. Now, that also referred back to, as far as the good and evil stuff, the battle that went on during the Second World War between liberal democracies, the free world, as it were, and totalitarianism, which was decidedly evil. So I think it created where you had all the divisiveness of Vietnam and the cynicism of Watergate, a new vision for society, culture, and individuals was being put together in some ways intentionally, but certainly it struck a chord that was positive, and it was done in a way that was going to appeal to families and people of all ages. And it's still relevant today because it was not set in the 70s. It was set in a galaxy a long time ago and a galaxy far away. But it was set in a world that was not planet-based but galaxy-based, if you see what I mean. So yes. I think it's going to have legs that are going to go for many generations until some other conception comes to pass. The other thing about the good and evil is, instead of romanticizing it, that everything's all good or all evil, it does acknowledge, as did Campbell and as do many of the great religions, and Christianity being one of them, that evil is present in all of us. We all have fallen natures. And so Luke's story and the story of Anakin does include all of that. And so therefore, whatever your faith, if you're looking at things from a spiritual dimension, it provides a touchstone to get a deeper understanding for one's own personal walk, whether you're a Christian or a pantheist or a Buddhist or Islam or Jewish or whatever. Star Wars can, as Joseph Campbell was trying to do in his work, help you develop a deeper understanding of your own faith.
Very well said. And I think it's easy to see why you give the introductory lecture at Washington National War College with answers like that. Very well said, my friend.
I don't know that I've referenced Star Wars yet, but I guess it's gonna, somebody's gonna, you know, say, hey, well, it's happened before in Washington.
Sure.
But,
well, hey, it's the eloquence, so we very much appreciate that. And that is probably one of the strengths, and you nailed it beautifully, the impact of culture. I like, even after what you just said, your reflections make me think about the idea that it is called A New Hope, and it seems like it was A New Hope for a lot of reasons, not just for Luke Skywalker and the galaxy, but mm-hmm. for us as a people as well. So I love that.
Yeah, yeah. And actually, could you tell me when the title was given to episode 4, New Hope? Was that in the re-releases? Because I don't it certainly wasn't called that in the 70s. But
I believe it was in 1979? I'm sure we're going to get 10,000 emails saying, no, it's
yeah,
this time.
It certainly wasn't
during the original release. I'm pretty sure it was right before Empire Strikes Back was about to come out, and then he decided, I want to put a subtitle here.
Oh, it wasn't it?
Really? It was that early.
Yeah, I think it was that early. Wasn't it in the beginning introduction when it, you know.
Not when it first came out.
It wasn't? Okay.
No, it was just the crawl? Was just Star Wars. Okay. Yeah, it was just Star Wars.
I think that would be an interesting discussion. You guys just pinged on that, and I'd never really thought about it. But yeah, when was it subtitled, and what does that say about George's evolution in his thinking?
Absolutely, it's the idea of bringing more to the story. Yeah,
see, it sounds like you're auditioning to be a regular on Coffee with Kenobi. With that kind
exactly.
Of
well, I'm auditioning you guys to come onto the TapCav site, and we can continue the conversation.
Oh, that would be our pleasure.
Yeah, let's do it.
Well, that would be awesome. When this talk about how you're explaining things so beautifully, clearly that's added to you as a writer, and I know you've written a book about a jazz great, which I want to ask you about in a little bit. But what is your actual vision for the official Star Wars blog, and how has your writing helped you reach out to fans in different ways?
Well, the Star Wars blog is really interesting. It's evolving, and it's going to be repackaged in the next few weeks, I think. They've asked for different material from all of us, and so I think it's going to have a new look. But
that's right. And we're not supposed to say that till July 1st, but that's from around we're going to release this anyway, so that's all good.
Yeah, so yeah, don't hold me to it because I don't know what the plan is. But if you've noticed the way the site has been in the last year or so, different people bring their own different strengths and their different interests to the site. You'll have some people that are blogging about Star Wars pastries and confectionery. and that's cool.
Absolutely.
Mary Franklin's very interested in that. She, I think she'd like to see people blogging, because she bartended at one point in her career up in Alaska. When I first met her, she was bartending for a Star Ladies convention, which was kind of fun back in 98 or 97. Anyway, so, I mean, I think she'd like to see, a Star Wars bar guide, a bartender's guide. But you have that sort of thing. Then you have Ashley would be blogging about fashion and Star Wars, haute couture and what have you. And then Brian Young blogging about the cinema behind Star Wars. What I blog about is that connectivity with the fans, because I think Matt enjoys that. There's other things. I did write a little bit about in the early days last year about becoming Dak and becoming Boba Fett, because I was really responding to the typical questions that I was getting from fans, such as you asked, how'd you get into Star Wars and how'd your life change, all that stuff. But recently, if you look back, what I'm essentially doing is reporting from the convention scene and telling the fan stories. I meet so many interesting people who are fans out there who have stories to tell. And that's what I like reflecting, what the fans are doing, particularly those that are active in the galaxy with either the Mandalorian mercs or the Garrison or the Rebel Legion. They're all doing good work out there for charities, many of which are focused on children, like Make-A-Wish. And they're using their Star Wars interests for higher purposes. For example, this one fella I recently included in a blog post on an appearance I did last month at the Corsham Star Wars Family Fun Day in Wiltshire in the West Country of England. And it was a family event. And this one fellow who is a teacher locally in that area out near Bristol and Bath, he had brought a steampunk astromech droid that he'd created. And he had done an interview with the BBC, and he said, it's a very much of a kind of a selfish thing when we're getting involved in creating our armor or these, we're building our droids and what have you. But it's wonderful also to use it for better purposes, such as raising money for children's charities and that sort of thing. And I think that's a very good story, that all of us are involved in Star Wars. And yet we're not doing it just because we're having fun and playing games and returning to our youth or being fascinated with building the best lightsaber. All of those things are being done for another purpose, which is giving back to our communities, however we define them, in such a way, but also bringing pleasure to families and children.
Very, very true. I love that. And I did do some research, and it looks like in 1981, when Episode 4 was re-released, they put A New Hope on there to fit into The Empire Strikes Back. So there's our answer.
It is. I think you ought to send something to the Lucasfilm folks. Tracy Kenobio?
Yes.
I think you ought to say, hey, look, Coffee with Kenobi would like to get an official statement from Lucasfilm as to the thinking that was behind that. We'd like to do a piece on it.
That's right. That would be very fun.
I think you should do that. I'm just going to plug this in because I'm running out of power.
Sure. Oh, sure. No problem.
Yeah. Hang on. Talk amongst yourselves, folks.
No problem.
Okay, we're good.
Okay. Well, talk to us a little bit about your involvement with Star Wars in the classroom, and how does your background in consulting, research, and analysis lend itself to being a member of the Special Ops team?
Well, it's sort of a work in progress right now. What we're discussing is how possibly to manage that. And see, I'm not a full-time teacher, nor a teacher that is in the classroom for middle school and high school, which is primarily the Rogues. But they have people like Vanessa Marshall, who's involved with this. And I think she's kind of working one angle that she wants to pursue. The main sort of subcategory of fans that I like to reach out to because of my military background, my naval background, is people who are veterans or active duty in the armed forces. And that's in every country. I've met some fabulous men and women, the Swedish Royal Air Force, to name one guy who was a fabulous guy, but also firefighters and EMTs and law enforcement who are all part of that Homeland Security and Emergency Management community, which I've been very much involved with since 1998, particularly around the time of Hurricane Katrina. So I think what I'm trying to do is find a way to bring in whatever understanding I have on my day job related to Star Wars in a way that I can exhort and hold up the men and women that are in those particular professions. What I have discussed a little bit is the idea that there might be some things in Rebels, and this again is at Pablo's suggestion on what he was indicating was some of the social and political and economic underpinnings of how they were conceiving Rebels when he made his presentation at the New York Comic Con, that there are certainly some examples in American history that we can look at, which if we follow the storylines as they'll come out of Rebels, we can use those as analogies to hopefully stimulate young people to take more of an interest in the history of this country, this country being America.
Absolutely.
So that if Star Wars can motivate people in the class to take seriously many of the things that they're studying in the social sciences, then we're doing our job.
And of course, I do know that one of your roles as being a part of Spec Ops is to go into Blue Leader's classroom, which, of course, is me. So we're going to have a lot of fun with that. We've got a lot of things that we're working on and kind of marinating over. And even these discussions we're having now, I really think it would be pretty exciting to incorporate Rebels into that and the American Revolution. I think it's going to be so rich, and I'm really excited to see my students react to speaking with you in that forum.
Yeah, well, I'd certainly want to respond to where they want to take the conversation, and I'd love if what you guys were talking about in some of the discussions on podcasting, I could sort of see a classroom being a virtual classroom, where certain little things in American history we can discuss, get insights from the kids on what they think they're seeing, and then maybe draw comparisons to what you find in some of the Star Wars.
Sure. Oh, it's going to be pretty exciting. I can hardly wait. And I think I mentioned this to you, but we had Ian Desher, William Shakespeare, Star Wars author, in a few months ago. And boy, did the students really, really got a big charge out of that. So
that is so cool.
Yeah, it was very fun. So in this interactivity that we're going to work with, and I think
with Vanessa Marshall, you'll find that because of her training, she went to Princeton.
Mm-hmm.
She's got a good brain, and she seems to be very much interested in the Joseph Campbell stuff that's current. I mean, what I remember about Campbell is kind of 10 years old, and if not longer. But I think she's very current, so that in terms of the psychology and cultural, I don't know what the term would be. I'm trying to think, but
I would say relevance.
Yeah, she might be, to have her sit in to talk to some of the kids about Joseph Campbell that would be interested in that social science area.
And she's a good friend of our show. She was actually on about a little over a month and a half ago.
I listened to it.
Oh, good, good. We had her on. We had Greg Weissman on. So, yeah, there's definitely some potential there. It's going to be a lot of fun.
Yeah, I'm thinking cultural anthropology. She would probably be very savvy on cultural anthropology and relating what she's doing with Rebels to that for the young people.
Wonderful idea. This is good. I need to be writing this stuff down. So I can't let you go without asking you about your book, Duke Ellington. Wow, let's talk about another legend. What a fan I am of him. Talk to us about that. How did that come about?
Well, I have a kind of a Catholic love of all kinds of music. I'm listening to a lot more to classical than anything else right now. But in the mid-90s, I was going through a country music phase. Country music was very strong, in my opinion, in that period, and I was listening to a lot of stuff. But I was just after about 3 or 4 years, drifting off and surfing the dials to back to the jazz stations. And I happened to pop onto a station while I was driving somewhere outside of Baltimore that was playing a jazz song. And this was a sax solo that was going on that was just really jumping. And knowing a fair amount about sound technology and what have you, I usually can make a determination as to, because of the miking and so forth, of what period of music it would be based on the technology. And I was tracking sort of 1948 to 1955. I had no idea who this was. And as I was trying to figure this out and kind of running through the Rolodex of who it could possibly be, I was coming up with Bill Haley and the Comets. That's not quite right. And then suddenly, this audience comes in that's just drowning out the sax solo. And I'm saying, holy smoke, this guy's causing a riot. Who in the world could this be? At which point, then suddenly this full orchestra comes in and just blows the roof off of this recording. And by this time, I'm beating the steering wheel and just having a great old time thinking, man, this is good stuff. This is like Grateful Dead, the Rolling Stones, the Who. I'm loving every minute of it. Hopefully the guy, when it finishes, is going to tell me who this is. And so the DJ fortunately did come on, and he said that was the great Duke Ellington Orchestra at Newport, 1956, with Paul Gonzalez on the saxophone playing diminuendo and crescendo and blue. And I said, holy smoke, I get it. That was my father's music, and I'm reacting to it as if it's mine. And my dad and I kind of fell out when Elvis Presley came along. So that just blew me away. I got to tell you, Dan, it was just blew me away. And about 2 years later, my wife and I were watching the Ken Burns series.
Oh, I love that series.
Yeah, and it profiled Duke Ellington and Louis Armstrong principally. And then around episode 9, it's getting up into that time when Ellington was at Newport. And I said, Gail, I think they're going to – remember that track I told you I was listening to? They'll probably get into the story. Well, sure enough, they did. And they talked about this blonde who was dancing that excited the band and got them all going and showed her picture and everything. And then they said that that was recorded and was Duke Ellington's most successful recording of all time. So when I finished this book on the U.S. Navy, I thought to myself, you know, I don't want to do another military book. I want to, you know, because I have this music background and stuff, I think I'm going to do a book on that night because it just moved me. So I spent 5 years researching this on spec. It took me a long time to get a publisher, which fortunately I got, which was Rutgers University Press. And they did a wonderful job. They enabled me to get 107 photographs in this book. So it's a great visual book. And I was able to interview two of the remaining members of Ellington's band from that night. I got to know one of Ellington's nephews. I met George Ween. I met the girl who did the dance, who was retired and living in Charleston, and also Elaine Lorillard, who was one of the founders of the Jazz Festival, and George Avakian, who produced the record. So I met all these fabulous folks, Wynton Marsalis.
Wow.
Clark Terry and John Sanders, who were two members of the band, and was immersed completely in this jazz world for 2 years or 5 years as I was writing this, in addition to doing my day job. I was getting up at 2 o'clock at night, you know, moonlighting, sometimes writing as much as 2 hours before I went back to sleep. It just took my life over, and I just had such a wonderful thrill doing it. What it did was enabled me to understand my father a lot more and understand that actually pop music did not begin with Elvis Presley. In fact, the people that were into Duke Ellington, you know, were just as enthusiastic about that world as we and our generation thought we were in ours. It was a great experience. I learned a lot, and I loved writing that book, and actually was very sorry when it was done.
Well, Corey's a writer. I'm sure he can certainly relate.
When you described doing the research and writing late at night and things like that, I'm certainly there with you. I write fiction myself, but just going back real quick to that jazz, I'm a big Frank Sinatra fan. I have over 500 Frank Sinatra songs. I read a book a couple of years ago. It was a biography on Sinatra called The Voice. It was excellent, and it was talks about, you know, you talked about pop songs and like that. I mean, I'm convinced that Frank Sinatra was the pioneer, if not Bing Crosby was a pioneer of pop music themselves, as far as, you know, the audiences and things like that. And it's a great book to listen to read. And then he would talk about some of the songs that Frank would sing. And I'd go back and listen to the song and then really be able to listen to it in a new light. But that's a totally different conversation. So.
Well, I always thought that Frank Sinatra said that his favorite song was One for My Baby and One for the Road. But other people are saying, no, that wasn't. But what's the deal? What was his favorite song, or did he have?
You know, it wasn't really clear as far as his favorite song. I don't want to come up with the wrong answer, but I'd have to look it back up. He does mention in his biography, it was really fascinating, the fact that you know, the struggles he had, where he could I mean, read the words of a song and then boom, go right into it and they have one take and it'd be done with, that's it, it's over. And
that's what Crosby was like,
famously
on film, I believe, as well.
I can believe it. Those guys were top of their game, and same with Duke Ellington. They're just guys that kind of talent is.
I can hear the music in my head.
Oh, absolutely. I'm kind of energized now. It's fascinating to.
This is why it's a coffee chat. You can hear
absolutely.
It in the background.
But I was going to say, it's like it connects perfect with our coffee. Yeah.
What was really nice about writing the book was that I had an excuse to, you know, get into the mood by just listening to jazz all the time.
Wow.
Yeah.
So there was this soundtrack of jazz that was just going on, you know, all kinds, just kind of giving me different insights and what have you. You know, you can't, you know, jazz isn't going to do that for you necessarily if you're writing about Homeland Security or
yeah,
stuff. It's, you tend to go with Beethoven, I think.
I love that. Well, and ironically enough, before I became such a podcast junkie, all I listened to was jazz. I must have heard Kind of Blue by Miles Davis 10,000 times.
Oh, yeah. I mean, there is that. That's the.
That's it.
Oh, that's the. Can't go. Yeah, right.
Well, it's been such an honor and a pleasure to speak with you, John. We certainly can't let you go without asking you our five questions we ask each of our guests here on Coffee with Kenobi. We'll just jump into the first one. What is your favorite Star Wars movie?
Empire Strikes Back.
Like a champ there.
I rehearsed this. I've got it. Yeah, I saw what you told me. I didn't have to think about any of them.
So. I was going
to
say, the one, of course, it's got to be the one he's in, of course, right?
That's not the reason why.
No. Oh, elaborate.
No, I'm just saying, I think it's the deeper of the original three.
Mm-hmm.
And I think Larry Kasdan had a lot to do with that.
Agreed, which gives me a lot of hope for episode 7.
Absolutely. Yes. Yeah.
Okay, John, your favorite character?
Chewbacca.
Cool.
Wow, I think you're the first person to say that.
Yeah, it is. Yeah.
Chewie. Yep.
What is your favorite line of dialogue or film moment?
Well, I love the scene in Dagobah where Yoda says, "My ally is the Force." That whole scene where he's interacting with Luke and basically telling him, you gotta believe it. If your ally is the Force and you believe it, and you, if you will, confess it with your mouth and believe it in your heart, you know, you can raise that X-wing.
It is a beautiful parallelism with Christianity, in my opinion.
Yeah, it is.
So, if you collect, what is your favorite collectible that you own?
Well, my favorite, I don't really collect. I've been giving a lot of stuff, but I'll tell you the Star Wars stuff that I have acquired. It comes from Acme Archive, which is the they're out in Burbank, California, and they've got the license to do a lot of Lucasfilm and Disney stuff. And there's this one artist who I think is just fantastic. Steve Thomas is his name. And he did one series around the time of Celebration 6 of travel posters that were in the genre of sort of Art Deco from the 1920s and what have you.
Uh-huh.
And I've got three. One is Echo Base Ski Patrol.
I've seen that.
Who needs a tauntaun when you've got skis? Another one which I've got is Alderaan by Moonlight, which is fantastic.
Wow.
That he did, which the moon is the Death Star. And then the third is Cloud City Tours, where you've got, the best, C. Bespin, from the air. And I got those. One guy came to get me to sign the Echo Base Ski Patrol. And when I saw the poster, I looked at it and I didn't get it. You know, I just said, "Oh, well, okay, I'll get this." And he said, "But are you sure you want me to sign this? This is a beautiful work of art." And he said, "Don't you get it?" And I said, "Well, let me look at it again." And I said, "Oh yeah, yeah, yeah. That's where you were, right? Yeah. Well, that's the guy that came and rescued me, right?" And he said, "Well, you're interested." I said, "I think I'd like to get this." And he said, "Well, you better go over there right now. There's only one or two left." So I went over, and sure enough, when I got there, the guy said, "Yeah, you're Dak, and you know, he was a good salesman." He said, "Well, you ought to get this one Bespin because you were there too." And I, so I bought those two posters, and I have them here, and I love them. They are fabulous.
They're beautiful.
There's a whole range of things that he's done. Acme's got some good stuff, but those I paid top dollar for, and I'm very glad I did. I think those are fine works of art. I like Star Wars themes that are represented in artwork, but not absolutely naturalistically. You know that you're just not just seeing a poster of Boba Fett, but it's somehow interpreted in a way The guy who runs Acme Archive, and I can't remember the artist's name, but he showed me one that was on that sort of giclée that looks like it's an original, but it's not. It's on a sort of a dappled board. Mm-hmm. He said this is a really good piece, and you saw R2-D2 and C-3PO in this sort of Nighthawks kind of environment, you know, at night. Yeah. And you see this train going off, and then the Death Star being constructed in the background. But it's this gritty early 20th century urban landscape, and it's very interpretive. And the guy said, "Well, no, this guy always does things with trains." And when George Lucas saw this, he said, "That's what I want." And so Lucas bought it. So the original George Lucas has.
Wow.
Oh, wow. That's cool. It's
very interpretive. But on the Acme Archives site, you can find it, but I cannot remember the name of the artist.
We'll have to look it up and put a link to that in our show notes.
Absolutely.
Yeah, well, there's another one, if I can belabor the point, that he did, which is before Lucas had any discussions with Disney. This guy does Disney work as well. And if you can imagine in silhouette, you're looking through a caboose towards the back platform, and in silhouette, the interior of the caboose is very dark. You can't see very much. You just know that it's the interior of a caboose. And in the far distance, the train is pulling away from Fantasyland, right?
Wow.
Which is in, you know, full color, you know, rendered beautifully. And in silhouette, standing on the back platform of this caboose, you see clearly a Walt Disney and a Mickey Mouse holding hands.
That's awesome.
Oh, cool.
It's a stunningly poignant work piece. You know, the guy's great, whoever he is.
We'll certainly put a link in our show notes for folks to check it out.
Yeah, those two. In fact, what I'll do is I'll send you, I'll look it up after we sign off, and I'll send you a I'll find it, because I don't remember the guy's name.
That'd be perfect.
I could find it. But yeah. If you think the fans would be interested, I'd love to point it out to them. But definitely the one with the train and R2-D2 and C-3PO. The guy said, yeah, this piece Lucas liked so much that he bought it for Skywalker Ranch, and he has it at his home.
That's so cool. So our last question here, what particular messages or themes about the Star Wars saga resonate or speak to you?
Well, I think it's the theme of the Force. I was raised by a British mother who was a war bride and an American father who was a naval officer, and they talked to me from my earliest age about two things, that there is your job as a young man is to grow up to live serving something that is greater than self. And from a naval officer's perspective, that means you know, giving up your own ambitions for the benefit of your country, if you will, and your service and your men and women that you're serving with. From my mother's perspective, she was more of an artist, and she looked at that sort of higher purpose in a very spiritual sense. And so the thing about Star Wars to me that's most essential is that appearances are not reality. There is a spirit world or an ideal world or what have you that has a deeper reality. And this is borne out in Campbell's writings, and I think what George feels himself, that Star Wars reflects, by virtue of the concept of the Force, that there is something that you cannot see that is something that inspires all of us, all of creation. And inspire comes from the Latin word spirit. So inspire means inspiriting. And, you know, it's, life isn't all about iPhones and iPads and what have you. It's what inspires those material things. And Star Wars, I think, does that in spades.
That's got goosebumps.
That. Yes. That. Well, we had James Arnold Taylor on, of course. He'll be one Kenobi from the Clone Wars. And we talked a lot about the spiritual connection with him as well. So I'm really glad that is the perfect way to end this coffee chat with John Morton, better known as Dak, to our Star Wars fans. John, it was an absolute pleasure and a thrill. And
yeah, well, it's great to be a part of this.
Absolutely.
I've been sort of following your tweets for a few months ever since I got Twitter savvy.
Yeah, you are very Twitter savvy. You are. Well, you definitely are. I remember when you first started following us before I even got a chance to speak with you. I thought that was a pretty big thrill. And then I made the connection that you also blog too, and I just thought, oh my goodness.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, and in fact, one of the podcasts I did recently was with Brian Young, and he was one of the first guys I studied before I started blogging with Star Wars. When they said they wanted me to do it, I went onto the site, and I really liked the stuff he was doing on the cinema behind Star Wars. I thought it was really, there was some good stuff there. So I practiced my blogging technique by commenting on several of his pieces.
Wow. I bet he would be really thrilled to hear that. And hopefully...
He knows.
Well, hopefully you got to see the one I just did recently on the Rogues.
Yes, yes. That was pretty neat.
And you're certainly welcome to come on anytime and have a cup of coffee with us. And we look forward to meeting you at Celebration Anaheim.
Oh, I hope I'm there. Yeah, and I look forward to meeting you guys too. And if you come up my way, Washington or whatever, let me know.
Thanks so much, John. It was a thrill talking to you. Love all the stories. Love all the background. Love the jazz talk. It was excellent.
Yeah.
So.
Good night, guys.
Thank you, John. So
thanks,
much.
John.
Pleasure.
Appreciate it. Have a good night.
Take care. Bye-bye.
Chewie, get us out of here!
If you would like to respond to our question of the show, have a comment, or just want to say hello, send us an email or MP3 at feedback@coffeewithkenobi.com. Or if you have a specific question or comment for either of us individually, email us at danz@coffeewithkenobi.com or corey@coffeewithkenobi.com or visit us at coffeewithkenobi.com and click on the Contact Us section or comment on one of the stories featured on the site. If you enjoy the show, please write a review in iTunes. You can also like the show on Facebook at facebook.com/coffeewithkenobi as well as keep up to date on our Twitter feed at twitter.com/coffeewithkenobi. You can also find us on Tumblr at coffeewithkenobi.tumblr.com. If you enjoy the jazz music, download the album Eye to Eye by Steve Torok on iTunes.
If you enjoy the jazz music playing right now, download the album The Complete Duke Ellington at Newport, 1956, courtesy of Sony Music Entertainment.
Give the evacuation code signal.
This podcast is not endorsed by the Walt Disney Company or Lucasfilm Limited. It is intended for entertainment and informational purposes only. The official Star Wars website can be found at www.starwars.com. Star Wars, all names, sounds, and any other Star Wars-related items are registered trademarks and or copyrights of Disney and their respective trademark and copyright holders. All original content of this podcast is the intellectual property of Coffee with Kenobi, unless otherwise indicated.
This is the podcast you're looking for.
Thank you. There's no one here. Move along. Move along.